So good morning everyone. We are going to start with our chapter number 10, that is of unit 5, moving to manufacture. So the topics here we are going to look into is what are you producing, designing kits, designing PCBs, software choices, the design process, manufacturing PCBs, etching boards, milling boards, assembling, testing, mass producing the case and other fixtures, certification, cost, scaling up the software, deployment, correctness, maintainability, security, performance, and user community. So let's begin. So before we start, first we should know that what do you mean by moving to manufacturing? So moving to manufacturing, to be very simple, means that you are going to start manufacturing in large quantities or in bulk. And this is something which is a very important activity, which will be always ongoing, and it will help you to improve the quality and the process of whatever you're going to produce. And with this activity, you're going to have a good financial gains as well if you have your good customers with you. So here we are going to answer a few questions related to it. The very first is, what are you are going to produce? So when we talk about production or producing, it is a method that will turn your raw materials or whatever inputs you have into finished good or products into your manufacturing process. So to be very simple, we can say that you are going to create something out of all the basic raw materials you have, and using that you are going to do the business and you are going to produce the good as per the customer requirements. So whenever we talk about manufacturing activity, it keeps on changing, like the amount of time and the money which you are going to invest for your product, it always keep on changing, because what you're producing, accordingly the time and the amount of money will vary, and the production process will take the steps accordingly. So whenever you are producing, and if you want to have more customers, you should always give some value added services to your customers. Like when you talk about, when you decide that you want to get your inventions, or when you want you have more customers, then in that case, you have to give customization. Customization is very important. And if you are giving the customization, definitely the people are going to be the part of your manufacturing process. So basically, when we talk about customization, you can either give a customized kit where the components can be selected by the customers and they can assemble themselves. Second, you can give a ready-made electronic board where the user can, according to their projects or according to their requirements, they can select and they can do the component soldering themselves. Otherwise, you can give a full-fledged electronic board where you will provide the in-house services to them as per their requirements. So you should give a lot of customization to your people, because if you're giving the customization, definitely they will be the part of your businesses. Next, we have this designing kits. So the very first step towards selling your idea, like if I talk about an IoT product, then kit is something which is very much essential. And mostly when we talk about IoT kits, these are the hardware kits that are designed for the rapid development of your IoT prototypes. So mostly these are those type of kits which will contain many components such as breadboards, jumper wires, your batteries, sensors, and actuators. So this is something which is very much important. Next we have is designing PCBs. So when I talk about designing kits, here you're going to look into more in detail, which is designing of your PCB. So whenever we talk about PCBs, they are also called as printed wiring boards, and they are called as printed wiring cards. You can see over your screen, there are cards which are of different sizes. So as per your requirement of your PCB, you can have of that type, and accordingly you can have it for your usage. So accordingly, you can have it. That is your PCB, which will have different types. So when we talk about PCB boards, these are the boards which act as a base in most of the electronics, and they can be as a physical support piece, or you can say there is a wiring area over the surface which is mounted along with the components which you want to have. So you can see over your screen, there is a PCB, and over that there are transistors, there are resistors, there are sensors which are already soldered, you can say, or which are already coupled with your PCBs. So mostly when we talk about manufacturing process, like initially when PCB has actually come into the picture, it was usually done manually. And with this manually, it used to become a very tedious task, because when we talk about designing the PCB, there is a lot of manual cutting, there is trimming, there is soldering of individual wires. So there is so much to do about it. And when you're going for a manual production, the time required used to be very much more, and it was prone to errors. Because in PCBs, the placement of wire is very much important. And if you have done mistake anywhere there, then your entire PCB will stop working. So you have to identify, you have to do it correctly. Even if there is one error, you have to check entire your wiring, and it used to be very much tedious. So now with this invention of the PCBs, which are ready-made PCB, you can say, or which are done with the help of the machines, this has actually eliminated the every difficulty, and you can get your PCBs with lot of accuracy. So since when we talk about mass production, mostly the people is asking for a complete PCB with all the components are already placed over them. They are soldered over it. So mostly they ask for a complete PCB. And this is something which is mass produced more rather than as compared to the handmade, or you can say hand-wired PCBs, which used to be done previously. So these are the three questions which we have answered. What are you producing? Designing kits and designing your PCBs. Next we have is PCB board types. So basically there are different types of boards, but the two boards which are commonly used is single-sided PCB and double-sided PCB. So when we talk about single-sided PCB, it will have only one layer of copper, and it is usually on the bottom of the board. So basically these are homemade type of circuits which has an whole components into it. Second, we have double-sided PCB. So this will have two layers of the copper, one on the top and another will be on the bottom. These are most complicated type of the PCB. The reason is that it is coppered on both. There are two copper layers on both the sided. So at times it becomes difficult which side to refer first. So it is somewhere at times very much complicated ones. Next we have is multi-layer PCB. So whenever you want to have multiple layers of copper, like 4 layers, 6 layers, 8 layers, then you can go with this multi-layer PCBs. So this type of PCBs are actually an extension to double-sided PCBs, you can say. And there are different layers of boards and insulating materials that separates your layers in the multi-layer PCB. So this type of PCBs you can see over your screen are of compact sizes, and they offer the benefits of weight and space. Mostly this type of PCBs are used for design flexibility, as they can easily move, you can say, or they can be easily folded. Next we have is rigid PCB. So the word itself is self-explanatory. These are those type of PCB where the base material is always going to be solid material, and here you cannot bend it. So this type of PCBs are though compact in nature, but the circuit you can say, or connection, is something which is very much complex. So here you are not going to do the circuit over the PCB, rather you are going to do around it. In other methods like single, double and multi-layer, whenever you are doing the circuit part, it is always over it, but you are in this rigid, you have your around it. Next we have is rigid flexible. This is the flexible type of PCB which is constructed over a flexible base, so you can easily bend it as per your requirement. This comes with single-sided, double-sided, and even multi-layer formats. So the reason it is, since it is flexible in nature, you can have it and it can save a lot of space, and it can actually reduce your overall board weight as well. Mostly this type of the PCBs are used when your board size is small and you want to have a high level of flexibility into it. Next we have is high frequency PCBs. So this high frequency PCBs will generate frequency ranges, and usually it is range of 500 megahertz to 2 gigahertz. And this type of the PCBs are basically used for critical applications, like you can say your communication systems, your microwave PCBs, and so on. Last category, we have aluminum backed PCBs. So these are the type of the PCBs which are used for high power applications. The aluminum construction helps you to dissipate the heat, and it offers high level of rigidity, and it will help you to control the thermal expansion. So this type of PCBs are usually suggested for the application where there is high mechanical tolerance, and this can be controlled with this type of PCBs. So these are the type of PCBs, that is your single-sided, double-sided, multi-layer, rigid flex, high frequency, and aluminium backed PCBs. Next, we are moving to the topic is software choices. So whenever we talk about manufacturing of PCBs, we are not directly going to start with the manufacturing activity. First, we are going to design the layout of the PCB, what circuits are going to be there, how the circuit designing will be, what components are going to be placed. So doing the PCB layout has to be done as a very first step before you start with the manufacturing activity. So there are different softwares which will help you to design the PCB layout, but the most common ones are KiCad, Fritzing, Autodesk Eagle, and Altium Designer. So these are the softwares which will help you to design your PCB layout. Because whenever we talk about PCB, this will bring your electronic circuits into life in the physical form. So whenever you're making any physical form, in that case, you have to do sketching. You have to first make a rough draft, or you can say a draft prototype. You have to verify that prototype, that whatever you have done, the circuit designing along with the components, whether it is done correctly or not. And then you should move to the manufacturing activity. Because once it is manufactured, you cannot make the changes. But if it is in a sketch form, you can easily change the placement of your components. You can change the schematic structure of the circuit. So this is possible in the schema, or it is possible something which is when you are done with doing with the help of the software, because it is just a layout. So the changes are possible. But once it is finally done, your actual physical form is ready. In that case, you cannot do the changes. Okay. So these are the some softwares which are used, which will help you to design the PCB layout. So the very first software we are going to look into is KiCad. So this is an open source software which will have a traditional workflow, but it has a comprehensive library which will have different components, and it will help you to design the boards up to 16 layers of coppers. So if you want to have multi-layer of coppers, as we have already studied before, 4, 8, 16, so in that case, if you want to do the designing part using the software, then KiCad can be a good option for you. Next we have is Fritzing. So Fritzing is again a free open source design package. And basically, this is the type of the software package which is good for the beginners who are new to the PCB design process. Because when we talk about embedded, or you can say IoT devices, usually the connection starts with breadboard. So most of the people doesn't have much idea about PCB. So those who have new to this PCB, they don't know the designing well, for them or for the beginners, Fritzing is a very good option, because it starts with the screen which looks like a breadboard, and where you can place all your components. You can design the prototypes. If you want to make any changes, you want to modify, that can be easily done. So Fritzing is a very good option for the beginners. And you can even export the breadboard version, whatever you have, into the schematic version or into an image or PDF file format. So it is very good for the beginners. Next we have is Autodesk Eagle. So Eagle here stands for Easily Applicable Graphical Layout Editor. So this was something which was developed by Tadsoft Computers Company. And this is again a PCB layout design software. So here you can design the schematic structure. You can design the different components as per your requirements. Mostly this is used for computer aided manufacturing only, because it has manufacturing features into it. Next we have last, that is your Altium Designer. So this is again a PCB layout design automation software. It was developed by an Australian company. And one of the most key features which is given by the software is real-time cost estimation and tracking. Because whenever you're going for a manufacturing activity where you're going to produce in bulk or masses, in that you should be knowing that what will be the cost of your per PCB. So if you get a proper estimation, if it is not fitting your pocket, then in that case you can modify the components that will fit in the pocket, and you can have your manufacturing activity as per your cost analysis. So Altium Designer gives you a value added features wherein you can have your cost estimation, and you can also do the tracking, and you can do the changes according to your requirement. So these are the four software choices. There are many software available, but these are something which are most commonly used for designing the layout of PCB. Next, we have design process of PCBs. So here we are going to see the design process that is using your Eagle Autodesk software. So the step number one is circuit designing using the software. So this is the very first initial step where you're going to draw the schematic circuit diagram with the software. So this is something which is important step, because whatever you want to have your circuit designing over your PCBs, you're going to design here. So this type of the software has a lot of library components and which will help you to build your circuits. You can simply drag and drop all the components, whatever you want. You can place the components as per your requirements, and you can come up with the designing of the circuit. So you simply have to just drop and drag, and you can come up with your circuit designing. You can have LEDs, you can have sensors, you can have actuators. All of these components are easily available into your libraries, and you can just simply drag and drop. So you can see your first screen is your schematic diagram screen, where you are just designing your schema, designing your circuit. Once it is finalized, and as soon as you are clicking on save option, the screen color changes. You can see the diagram too. You can see a black screen. So now it tells you that your circuit designing has been saved. So you can export into any file format, whichever you want. Mostly it is exported in an image file format. So this is your step number one, where you are going to do the circuit designing using your Eagle software. Next, you have your step number two, that is your FLIM generation. So when we talk about FLIM generation, this is the finalized circuit board output, you can say, which you get from your step number one. And this is the layout, whichever is going to be finalized, and it is going to be sent to the manufacturing. Okay. So as per your manufacturer requirement, if they want a negative image, then you can give a negative image of the circuit, or else if they want a plastic coated masking, then you can give that also. So this is your FLIM generation, that your final circuit diagram is ready, and now it can be go for the next further processing. Step number three is selecting the raw material. So this is something which is a very important step, where you're going to select the raw material. So when we talk about PCB raw material, mostly those are unbreakable glass. So we are going to use a fiberglass, which will have copper foil bounded, depending on what type of PCB you're going to go for. If you're going for a double-sided PCB, then the copper foil bounding will be done on both the sides. If it is a single-sided, then it will be on the single side only. So the reason of selecting an unbreakable glass is something, it has to be flexible. It has to be something which has to be durable. So that is why we are using an unbreakable glass. And this is also something which is less expensive as well. So this is your step number three, that is selecting your raw material for your PCB. Next, we have a step number four, that is preparing the drill holes. So here in this step, you are going to drill holes into your PCB. Since you know that PCB doesn't come with a standard, or you can say a fixed size, the size keeps on changing depending on the requirement. So drilling holes, something which is a very complex task, because when we talk about drilling holes, there are two types of drilling holes. One is your handmade machines drilling holes, and second is your CNC machine. So whenever you're going for a handmade machine drilling holes, there is a lot of human intervention is required, and there is a lot of efforts also required while drilling the holes. Because when we talk about PCB drilling, all the holes distances has to be of a standard size. Okay. And when you're going with the handmade machines, in that case, it becomes difficult if the size of the PCB is small, because every hole will have a standard distance between them. So it is always suggested that you should go for a CNC machines, because these are the computer based machines, and this will do this task with accuracy. All that is required, that whatever is your drilling pattern, how many holes you want, what is the distance, all that patterns has to be stored into your computers, like your drill bit sizes. And according to the pattern, whatever you have saved, it will start with the drilling process. Next, we have step number five, that is applying the image. So this applying of the image is nothing but whatever is your circuit designing, which has been finalized. Now you're going to print this over a copper plate. So whenever you're going with this step of applying image, you can use different techniques, like you can use manual pens to do the same, pen plotters, but mostly we go for a printers because something which will give you a high accuracy and clarity of the image, so we go for the printers. So mostly we use laser printer here because these are something which will give you or will help you to print the layouts over your PCBs. So whenever you're doing this step of this printing, you have to always make sure that the copper paper which you are inserting into the laser printer, you clean it very well, because if the cleaning is not done, the printing will not be clear. So in that case, you have to always clear your copper paper before inserting into the laser printer. Once you are done with it, the design, whatever you want to have it to over it, you have to place it over your computers, and after the print command, you can see the printing process starts. So that is what step number 5, where you are going to apply the image. That is nothing but printing your circuit design over the copper paper. Next, we have the step number 6, that is your etching. So as we all know that whenever we start with the designing process of PCB, there is a lot of unwired copper on the edges of the PCB boards or between the circuits. So we are going to remove the unwired copper or any other filaments which are there, which is unwanted over the PCBs. We are going to remove it in this etching step. So basically here we are going to prepare a chemical which will have different acids like ferric chloride, your ammonium, your sodium hydroxide, sodium, calciums, and many other substances will be there along with the water, and you are going to immerse your PCB into it, and you have to keep it for the while so that it is going to do the cleaning of your PCB board. If required, if you think your PCB board is still greasy, then you can take a brush and you can do the cleaning so that your etching process is something which will clean your PCB boards, because the next step is testing. And if your boards are not cleaned properly, the testing activity will not take place. So in etching step, that is your step number 6, you are going to do the cleaning of your PCB board, and any unwanted copper wires or any substances which is there over the board is going to be cleaned by immersing this board into the acid liquid which you have prepared. Next is your step number 7, that is the testing. So before moving for the manufacturing activity, your board should undergo a testing which will check whether the PCB is working correctly or not. Nowadays, we are going for a automated testing only, because manual testing will take a lot of time. When we talk about manufacturing, it is manufacturing in bulk, in large quantities. So we'll always go for an automation testing. So basically, ATG testing is done where there are ATG machines, which are like flying probe, or you can say fixtureless testers, and which will test your PCB working. So this was your design process using your Eagle Autodesk software from step 1 to step 7. Next we have is etching boards. We have already seen in step number 6, what do you mean by etching? So here you're going to take in much more detail that what is all about. So when we talk about etching boards, this is some of the most common PCB making technique for your home use, like you are going to etch the board. Okay, so etch the board here refers to that you are going to do the cleaning of your board. You are going to prepare an acid, and this acid will help you to remove any unwanted copper which is there in your PCB. So if you want your circuits which you have already done design over your PCB board, if you want them, that acid should not affect them, then you can do a lamination of your PCBs of only those circuit areas which has been done. Rest other extra filaments which are there on the either of the board, that you don't need to laminate it. Just put that into the liquid and leave it for a while so that the cleaning of the board will take place. So over your screens, you can see step number 1, 2, and 3. In step number 1, a liquid is prepared, and in the liquid, that particular PCB is being placed. In step number 2, you can see that the PCBs are cleaning. That is the step number 2, that the PCB is being cleaned. After removing from the step, you have to put it in the plain water so that cleaning will take place. If you need brushing, then you can do it in step number 2. Then you have a step number 3, where your PCB has completely clean. You can see the difference between 2 and 3. In step number 2, there are still some red filaments, copper filaments between the circuits. But in step number 3, you can see it is completely done. So this is your etching board. Basically, this is a subtractive process. The reason why it is subtractive process, here you are going to do the cleaning of your material. and at each step the copper substances are being removed. So that is why it is called as a subtractive process. So as I've already told you before, you can do the lamination also for the circuit. If you want your circuit to be untouched, the acid should not affect the circuits which you have done before. So that is also possible with your etching step. So this is something which is very much important step, because after this step, the testing will take place. So cleaning of your etching board is very much important. Next we have is milling boards. So when we talk about milling, that is nothing but the process of removing the areas of the copper from a sheet of printed circuit boards, and with using that you can recreate whatever you want to create, maybe pads or a structure. So basically in your over your screen you can see that using the CNC machine your circuit designing is taking place, and you can see a lot of copper filaments are there on the sides of the board. So basically in this etching process, whatever extra copper is there or any unwanted copper which is there is being removed. Okay, since you are using a CNC machine for doing the same, that is a digital circuit board designing, you have to always make sure that the board material has to be very much durable, because your CNC machines are very, very much heavy, and if your board size is weak, in that case this process will not take place. So your board size has to be very much strong. It has to be something which is durable. So here in this milling process, the digital circuit designing using the CNC machine will take place over your PCB. And whatever extra copper which is there is going to be removed with the liquid which you are going to prepare in the etching board step. Next we have is assembling. So assembling is something which is a very important activity, and it is always an ongoing activity, because your customer requirements will keep on changing. According to their requirements, you have to assemble, or you can say solder, the new components. So this is always ongoing activity. So whenever we talk about assembling, it is just simply soldering of your components over your PCBs or over your electronic boards. So as per your customer requirements, you can assemble the new components. In case if there is no new components, then whatever components which are already assembled, you need to test them whether they are working correctly or not. In assembling, if there is any new components you have assembled, then the testing is always required before you go for the manufacturing activity. So this is something which is an activity which is done before your product is out in the market. So assembling and testing, this has to be done. If you have a knowledge of soldering, then you can go for in-house assembling. If you don't have knowledge of soldering, then you should go for an outsourcing, because when you talk about electronic circuits assembling, or you can say soldering, there are very small and fragile components. So in that case, soldering requires a lot of precision. So if you don't have much knowledge, you should go for an outsourcing only. But after doing the assembling, it is very, very much important that you should do the testing of it before it goes out of the market. So you will be assured from your end that this has been tested and it is working properly. Next topic we have is mass producing the case and other fixtures. So here basically refers to that whenever you're going for the mass production of other cases, you can say other components or other fixtures, how to go about and what are the different mass production cases as well. So whenever you go for mass production, it is always suggested that if you want to control your cost of production, you should go for buying machines rather than hiring people. So that is one of the good thumb rule I can say whenever you are going for mass production, because if you hire the people, every people will have their different skill set. If they don't match your skill set, then again you have to find another one, and the cost will also increase. So whenever you are going for a mass production, rather than hiring the people, you can replace the people with the machines, and that in that case the accuracy of the result will also be there, and this will help you to produce the result in lesser time, because machines are always going to be cheaper than people. This you always have to be remember when we talk about mass production. So here in this you can see there is a CNC machine, and in this CNC machine there is a tooling kit. With that toolkit is nothing but a molding kit which is being used, and it is doing the molding of the plastic. So whenever you want to do molding of any fixtures, or you can say any materials, you can do it. You can use a CNC machine. Along with that, you can attach the injection molding toolkit from which the molding will come out. with the material which you have inserted into the machine. So material can be plastic or any type of molding, whichever you want. Okay. So basically, when we talk about process of injecting the plastic into mold, you need to have a mold which is separated over it, and you should place your materials over it. So that is something which is an important activity to be done. The most expensive part, if you talk about your injection molding, is producing the mold, because the injection toolkit which is there, it is very much fragile. So at times it breaks also easily. So this is something which is expensive and it really needs to be taken care of. Okay. So the molding can be of steel molding, it can be aluminium, it can be plastic, depending on what you want. So basically there are two types of mechanism for molding which is done here. One is a straight pull and second is multi-shot. So when I talk about straight pull, this is one of the simplest molding activity, and it is divided into two parts. So there is side A and there is a side B. This is the two type of molding which is there. So these are the two types which are being there, and using this molding you can do the design process. So whenever you want to have your vertical faces, then in that case you will go with this type of molding, that is your straight pull. Second is your multi-shot molding. So when we talk about multi-shot, these are the second category of molding where you can inject two different materials, or either if you are injecting same material, you can have moldings of different colors. So that is your multi-shot molding, which will help you to have different volumes. You will have different colors and you can inject them accordingly. Next, we are moving to the topic, that is certification. So certification is something which is very, very much important, because you as a manufacturer, if you are giving service to your customer in bulk or in large quantities, whatever you are producing, that needs to be certified and along with the standards, and the certification is something which is very much important. Because if you give a certification, you are giving an extra level of assurance to your customers that it has been certified, it has been tested with the standards. So whenever we talk about certification, it is usually certificate of compliance, which will have fields like certificate number, which is a unique field. Next, you have an applicant and manufacturer. So one who is applying for the certificate, their name will come under applicant. One who is doing the manufacturing activity, the name will come. In that case, applicant and manufacturer can have both the same address or information, you can say. Product which has been certified, which has been tested, the name of that product. And testing standards, which standard has been used to test. According to the different countries, the standard keeps on changing. This is an European standard which will have fields like CE, FCC and UL. So this is something which is an important, you are going to give it to your customer, that is a certificate and assurance that whatever they are buying has been certified with the standards and you can use them for a longer time. So mostly when we talk about testing of your PCBs, we usually go for EMC testing, that is electromagnetic compatibility testing. So this testing usually ensures that your electrical or your electronic device will not emit any amount of electromagnet interference. So this is something which is usually done so that anybody who is using this device can use this device for a longer time. So this is something which is very, very much important activity which has to be done. So once you are done with your in-house assembling and testing, then only you should apply for certification, because first check has to be done from your end, and then you're going to do this activity. You are applying for a standard and telling them to check and give you the certificate. So depending on different devices and different functionalities, the testing activity will keep on changing. Next we have is cost. So cost is something which is an important activity which you have to do in your manufacturing process. So cost estimation has to be done always, because if you want to generate enormous profit, cost estimation has to be calculated at every point of time. So for cost analysis, you are going to design a Gantt chart wherein you will have all your tasks along with the weeks. In week, you can divide your projected weeks and the actual time which is taken. You can even add one more section, that is the cost for each week which is being there, so that you can have a very much cost analysis. Because whenever you are going for manufacturing activity, the cost keeps on increasing. The reason why it is increasing, because there are many external factors which come into the pictures which you really cannot control, and because of that the cost keep on increasing. So cost analysis has to be done at very much crucially, you can say, and this is something which is very much important. As soon as you are moving at the end of the manufacturing activity, your more concentration is not over coding or designing, but your more concentration is over that how you are going to balance your cash flow. And in case if you have, you are the part of fundraising project, then you have to take care of that cost as well. So this is something you have to take care of mostly, because whatever profits you are going to generate, that is going to become the input for the next manufacturing activity. So the cost analysis has to be done at each and every step so that you don't suffer from cash crunch at the end of the activity. Next we have is scaling up the software. So whenever we talk about scaling up the software, that refers to how easily you can add resources, how easily you can scale. That is called as scaling up your software. So whenever you're producing a physical thing, yeah, like a prototype, or you can say as a manufactured product, you have different propositions. Like when we talk about scaling, there are different aspects of scaling. Like it will be with respect to size, shape, color, material, finishing, quality. So whatever you have in your in-house shelf, accordingly you're going to do the scaling up. Okay. So when we talk about software scaling, it doesn't comes with shape, size and all, because it is intangible in nature. Okay. But whenever we talk about physical design, it usually comes with those type of aspects. So whenever you're doing scaling up of the software, you really need to take care of few factors, you can say, or few characteristics which you are going to look into now. So the very first is deployment, or which is also called as deploy. So whenever you talk about scaling of the software, okay, just a software, a working software, then that is copying the software from development machine to the production machine, that is called as deployment. Okay. But if I talk about a physical design, a physical IoT, you can say kit, in that case, deployment will refer to as shipping. So deployment is something which will keep changing. Its meaning will keep changing according to what activity you are performing. If I'm performing an online software activity, so in that case, copying from one place to another is called as deployment. But if I'm doing a manufacturing activity where I'm shipping my physical circuits, then in that case, deployment will be referred as shipping. So according to the task which you're going to do, the deployment will keep on changing. Next we have is correctness. Correctness, it simply what refers to, your input should be matched with the corresponding outputs. Whatever inputs are there, if they are matching with your output, then the correctness has to be there. Okay. So in software, the correctness is very easy, as you have your debugging tools. Using the debugger, you can debug if there are any problems, if your source code is generating any bugs or fixes. In that case, with the debugger, you can do it. But if I talk about embedded platform, or if I talk about IoT kit, in that case, correctness becomes very difficult to rectify. Because if any of your components suddenly stop working, you don't know which component has stopped working, and you have to check all the components which are placed over your breadboards. So the correctness with respect to your embedded code or embedded devices is something which is very difficult, and fixing the error takes a lot of time. In contrast to this, if I talk about software correctness or software bug fixing, that is something which is very much easy and can be easily done. Next we have is maintainability. So maintainability is something how you're going to maintain your software. So basically we're going to give an after sales service to the customers, which will help you to increase, or you can say maximize the performance. Like when we talk about software, we usually give the software updates. So with the new updates, you can see the performance has enhanced, and you can see the bugs which are there in the previous update has been rectified. So maintainability is something which is an important activity which has to be done, and which will help you to maximize the performance. Because if your performance is maximized, your risk will be minimized and your cost will also be minimized. The cost of fixing the errors will be minimized, in very simple words. Next we have is performance. So performance is something which is a very key characteristic which every customer is going to test, you can say, and they are going to check what is the performance of your device. Usually whenever you talk about performance, it is very much important that you first check the performance of your device how is it working, and you rate yourself how, what is the rating of the performance of your device. It can be bad, poor, average, good, and excellent. Because once it goes out of the market, people are going to give the feedback on the basis of the performance as a characteristic only. So it is important that you test your code, you test your device before it goes out, and make sure that the performance level is high. And whatever key points which you are specifying about your product, this my product is going to be 24/7 up, or whatever key functionalities which are going to be the part of your performance, that all has to be present. So performance is something which is very important characteristic. And if your performance is high for a longer time, you're going to have a good relationship with your customers. Next we have is user community. So user community is nothing but the set of users or the people who are going to be your indebted customers who have interest in your manufacturing activity, or you can say interest into what you are going to produce. So you have to identify who are your targeted customers and they belong to which community. So accordingly, you are going to give the, you can say, value added services to them. You are going to do the mass market launching, or you can say free samples to your user community, because these are the people who are going to refer other people. And in that case, they are going to help you to grow your business. So now the platform is very much big. Now we have a social platform. We can have Twitter, Facebook, and different social medias. So it is very easy to have a good user community people, which will help you to build your business. Even you can go for a blogging for your product. You can give free samples, any means to attract your customers or user community. Last, we have the characteristic, or you can say the scaling up software factor, that is your security. Security is something which is very, very much important, and it has to be there into your devices, because somebody crucial or confidential information, if it is shared across different platforms, then it is really not acceptable. So you should have a security implementation into your devices. All the information which is saved, that is your confidential information, that's your password, it should not be saved in the plain text. Rather, it should be saved in the encrypted text, so that if anybody can have an access, then in that case, they won't understand what it's all about. Mostly when we talk about security, the more concern is when you are connecting remote devices or when there is a remote communication between the client and server. So some important guidelines which really needs to be taken care, that your servers which are saving your passwords, that needs to be updated frequently with the security patches. Try to have good firewalls so that if your password is going out of the network, it is not going in the plain text, rather it is going in the encrypted text. Try to have different mechanisms, secure algorithms which will protect your passwords, and so on. So this is something, a security implementation which has to be there, and this is something which is very, very much required when we talk about scaling up the software. So these are the six important factors which really need to be considered when you are thinking of scaling up the software. So scaling up the software, you are not just refers to purely software, but also into your embedded devices or IoT devices when you are thinking of scaling up the software. Okay, so that's it for the day. Hope everybody have understood this chapter. Thank you, everyone.